The following is a free-for-download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Part 2, Chapter 8. Lord Nrsingadev slays the king of the demons. As described in this chapter, Hiranyakashipu was ready to kill his own son, Prahlad Maharaj. But the Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared in front of the demon as Sri Nrikshari, half lion and half man, and killed him. Following the instructions of Prahlad Maharaj, all the sons of the demons became attached to Lord Vishnu, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When this attachment became pronounced, their teachers, Sanda and Amarka, were very much afraid that the boys would become more and more devoted to the Lord. In a helpless condition, they approached Hiranyakashipu and described in detail the effect of Prahlad's preaching. After hearing of this, Hiranyakashipu decided to kill his son, Prahlad. Hiranyakashipu was so angry that Prahlad Maharaj fell down at his feet and said many things just to pacify him, but he was unsuccessful in satisfying his demoniac father. Hiranyakashipu, as a typical demon, began to advertise himself as being greater than the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But Prahlad Maharaj challenged him, saying that Hiranyakashipu was not God, and began to glorify the Supreme Personality of Godhead, declaring that the Lord is all-pervading, that everything is under him, and that no one is equal to or greater than him. Thus, he requested his father to be submissive to the omnipotent Supreme Lord. The more Prahlad Maharaj glorified the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the more angry and agitated the demon became. Hiranyakashipu asked his Vaishnava son whether his god existed within the columns of the palace, and Prahlad Maharaj immediately accepted that since the Lord is present everywhere, he was also present within the columns. When Hiranyakashipu heard this philosophy from his young son, he decided the boy's statement was just the talk of a child and forcibly struck the pillar with his fist. As soon as Hiranyakashipu struck the column, there issued forth a tumultuous sound. At first, Hiranyakashipu, the king of the demons, could not see anything but the pillar. But to substantiate Prahlad's statement, the Lord came out of the pillar in his wonderful incarnation as Narsingha, half lion and half man. Hiranyakashipu could immediately understand that the extraordinary, wonderful form of a Lord was surely meant for his death, and thus he prepared to fight with the form of half lion and half man. The Lord performed his pastimes by fighting with the demon for some time, and in the evening, on the border between day and night, the Lord captured the demon, threw him on his lap, and killed him by piercing his abdomen with his nails. The Lord is not only killed Hiranyakashipu, the king of the demons, but also killed many of his followers. When there was no one else to fight, the Lord, roaring with anger, sat down on Hiranyakashipu's throne. The entire universe was thus relieved of the rule of Hiranyakashipu, and everyone was jubilant in transcendental bliss. Then all the demigods headed by Lord Brahma approached the Lord. These included the great saintly persons, the Pitas, the Siddhas, the Vidyadharas, the Nagas, the Manus, the Prajapatis, the Gandharvas, the Charnas, the Yakshas, the Kimpurushas, the Vaitalikas, the Kinaras, and also many other varieties of beings in human form. All of them stood not far from the Supreme Personality of Godhead and began offering their prayers unto the Lord, whose spiritual effulgence was brilliant as he sat on the throne. Text 1. Narada Muni continued, all the sons of the demons appreciated the transcendental instructions of Prahlad Maharaj and took them very seriously. They rejected the materialistic instructions given by their teachers, Sanda and Amarka. Purport. This is the effect of the preaching of a pure devotee like Prahlad Maharaj. If a devotee is qualified, sincere, and serious about Krishna consciousness, and if he follows the instructions of a bona fide spiritual master, as Prahlad Maharaj did when preaching the instructions he had received from Narada Muni, his preaching is effective. it as it is said in Srimad Bhagavatam 3:25:25, Satam Prashangam Mama Virya Samvido Bhavanti Hrit Karana Rasayana Kata. If one tries to understand the discourses given by the Sat, or pure devotee, those instructions will be very pleasing to the ear and appealing to the heart. Thus, if one is inspired to take to Krishna consciousness, and if one practices the processes in his life, he is surely successful in returning home, back to Godhead. By the grace of Prahlad Maharaj, all his class friends, the sons of the demons, became Vaishnavas. They did not like hearing from their so-called teachers, Sunda and Amarka, who were interested only in teaching them about diplomacy, politics, economic development, and similar topics meant exclusively for sense gratification. Text 2. When Sanda and Amarka, the sons of Shukracharya, observed that all the students, the sons of the demons, were becoming advanced in Krishna consciousness because of the association of Prahlad Maharaj, they were afraid. They approached the king of the demons and described the situation as it was. Purport. The words Buddhim Ekanta Shamstitam indicate that as an effect of Prahlad Maharaj's preaching, the students who listened to him became fixed in the conclusion that Krishna consciousness is the only object of human life. The fact is that anyone who associates with a pure devotee and follows his instructions becomes fixed in Krishna consciousness and is not disturbed by material consciousness. The teachers particularly observed this in their students, and therefore they were afraid because the whole community of students was gradually becoming Krishna conscious. Texts 3 and 4. When Hiranyakashipu understood the entire situation, he was extremely angry, so much so that his body trembled. Thus, he finally decided to kill his son, Prahlad. Hiranyakashipu was by nature very cruel, and feeling insulted, he began hissing like a snake trampled upon by someone's foot. His son Prahlad was peaceful, mild, and gentle. His senses were under control, and he stood before Hiranyakashipu with folded hands. According to Prahlad's age and behavior, he was not to be chastised. Yet, with staring, crooked eyes, Hiranyakashipu rebuked him with the following harsh words. Purport. When one is impudent toward a highly authorized devotee, one is punished by the laws of nature. The duration of his life is diminished, and he loses the blessings of superior persons and the results of pious activities. Hiranyakashipu, for example, had achieved such great power in the material world that he could subdue practically all the planetary systems in the universe, including the heavenly planets, Svargaloka. Yet now, because of his mistreatment of such a Vaishnava as Prahlad Maharaj, all the results of his tapasya diminished, as stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 10.4.46. Ayushriyam yaso dharman lokan ashishadevacha hanti shayamsi sarvani pumsha mahad atikrama. Quote, when one mistreats great souls, his lifespan, opulence, reputation, religion, possessions, and good fortune are all destroyed, end quote. Text 5. Hiranyakashipu said, O most impudent, most unintelligent disruptor of the family, O lowest of mankind, you have violated my power to rule you, and therefore you are an obstinate fool. Today I shall send you to the place of Yamaraj. Purport. Hiranyakashipu condemned his Vaishnava son, Prahlad, for being Durvinita, ungentle, uncivilized, or impudent. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, however, has derived a meaning from this word, Durvinita, by the mercy of the goddess of learning, Saraswati. He says that Du refers to this material world. This is confirmed by Lord Krishna in his instruction in Bhagavad Gita that this material world is Dukaliam, full of material conditions. V means Vishesha, specifically, and Nita means, quote, brought in, end quote. By the mercy of the Supreme Lord, Prahlad Maharaj was especially brought to this material world to teach people how to get out of the material condition. Lord Krishna says, Yada yada hi dharmasya glani bhavata parata. When the entire population or part of it becomes forgetful of its duty, Krishna comes. When Krishna is not present, the devotee is present, but the mission is the same, to free the poor conditioned souls from the clutches of the Maya that chastises them. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur further explains that the word mandatmam means manda, very bad or very slow in spiritual realization. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1.1.10, manda sumanda matayo manda bhagya. Prahlad Maharaj, who is the guide of all mandas, or bad living entities who are under the influence of Maya, he is the benefactor even of the slow and bad living entities in this material world. Kula Beda Karadama. By his actions, Prahlad Maharaj made great personalities who established big, big families seem insignificant. Everyone is interested in his own family and in making his dynasty famous, but Prahlad Maharaj was so liberal that he made no distinction between one living entity and another. Therefore, he was greater than the great Prajapatis who established their dynasties. The word shtabdam means obstinate. A devotee does not care for the instructions of the asuras. When they give instructions, he remains silent. A devotee cares about the instructions of Krishna, not those of demons or non-devotees. He does not give any respect to a demon, even though the demon be his father. Much shasano drivatam. Prahlad Maharaj was disobedient to the orders of his demoniac father, Yamakshayam. Every conditioned soul is under the control of Yamaraj, but Hiranyakashipu said that he considered Prahlad Maharaj his deliverer, for Prahlad would stop Hiranyakashipu's repetition of birth and death. Because Prahlad Maharaj, being a great devotee, was better than any yogi, Hiranyakashipu was to be brought among the society of bhakti yogis. Thus, Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur has explained the words in a very interesting way, as they can be interpreted from the side of Saraswati, the mother of learning. Text 6. My son Prahlad, you rascal, you know that when I am angry, all the planets of the three worlds tremble along with their chief rulers. By whose power has a rascal like you become so impotent that you appear fearless and overstep my power to rule you? Purport. The relationship between a pure devotee and the Supreme Personality of Godhead is extremely relishable. A devotee never claims to be very powerful himself. Instead, he fully surrenders to the lotus feet of Krishna, being confident that in all dangerous conditions, Krishna will protect his devotee. Krishna himself says in Bhagavad Gita 9.31, Kuntiya pratijanihi name bhaktya pranashiti. Quote, O son of Kunti, declare boldly that my devotee never perishes. End quote. The Lord requested Arjuna to declare this instead of declaring it himself, because sometimes Krishna changes his view and therefore people might not believe him. Thus, Krishna asked Arjuna to declare that a devotee of the Lord is never vanquished. Hiranyakashipu was perplexed about how this 5-year-old boy could be so fearless that he did not care for the order of his great, very great and powerful father. A devotee cannot execute the order of anyone except the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is the position of a devotee. Hiranyakashipu could understand that this boy must have been very powerful, since the boy did not heed his orders. Hiranyakashipu asked his son, Kimbala, quote, how have you overcome my order? By whose strength have you done this? End quote. Text 7. Prahlad Maharaj said, my dear king, the source of my strength, of which you are asking, is also the source of yours. Indeed, the original source of all strength is one. He is not only your strength or mine, but the only strength for everyone. Without him, no one can get any strength, whether moving or not moving, in superior or inferior. Everyone, including Lord Brahma, is controlled by the strength of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Purport. Lord Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 10.41, Yad yad vibhutimat sattvam srimad urjitam evava tat tat evavagachatvam mama tejo mishasambhavam. Quote, know that all beautiful, glorious, and mighty creations spring but from a spark of my splendor," end quote. This is confirmed by Prahlad Maharaj. If one sees extraordinary strength or power anywhere, it is derived from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. To give an example, there are different grades of fire, but all of them derive heat and light from the sun. Similarly, all living entities, big or small, are dependent on the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One's only duty is to surrender, for one is a servant and cannot independently attain the position of master. One can attain the position of master only by the mercy of master, not independently. Unless one understands this philosophy, he is still a mudha. In other words, he's not very intelligent. The mudhas, the asses who do not have this intelligence, cannot surrender to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Understanding the subordinate position of the living entity takes millions of births, but when one is actually wise, he surrenders unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Lord says in Bhagavad Gita, Bahunam janmanamante genamamapapadyate swasadevam sarvamiti samahatma sadurlabha. Quote, after many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me, knowing me to be the cause of all causes and all that is. Such a great soul is very rare, end quote. Prahlad Maharaj was a great soul, a Mahatma, and therefore he completely surrendered unto the lotus feet of the Lord. He was confident that Krishna would give him protection under all circumstances. Text 8. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the Supreme Controller and Time Factor, is the power of the senses, the power of the mind, the power of the body, and the vital force of the senses. His influence is unlimited. He is the best of all living entities, the controller of the three modes of material nature. By his own power, he creates this cosmic manifestation, maintains it, and annihilates it also. Purport. Since the material world is being moved by the three modes of material modes, and since the Lord is their master, the Lord can create, maintain, and destroy the material world. Text 9. Prahlad Maharaj continued, My dear father, please give up your demonic mentality. Do not discriminate in your heart between enemies and friends. Make your mind equipoised toward everyone. Except for the uncontrolled and misguided mind, there is no enemy within this world. When one sees everyone on the platform of equality, then one comes to the position of worshiping the Lord perfectly. Purport. Unless one is able to fix the mind at the lotus feet of the Lord, the mind is impossible to control. As Arjuna says in Bhagavad Gita 6:34, Chanchalam hi mana Krishna pramati baladvadridam tasyaham nigraham manye vairiva saduskaram. Quote, for the mind is restless, turbulent, obstinate, and very strong, O Krishna, and to subdue it, it seems to me, is more difficult than controlling the wind, end quote. The only bona fide process for controlling the mind is to fix the mind by service to the Lord. We create enemies and friends according to the dictation of the mind, but actually there are no friends and enemies. Pandita Sarmadarshana. To understand this is the preliminary condition for entering into the kingdom of devotional service. Text 10. In former times, there were many fools like you who did not conquer the six enemies that steal away the wealth of the body. These fools were very proud, thinking, quote, I have conquered all the enemies in all the ten directions, end quote. But if a person is victorious over the six enemies and equipoised toward all living entities, for him there are no enemies. Enemies are merely imagined by one in ignorance. Purport. In this material world, everyone thinks that he has conquered his enemies, not understanding that his enemies are his controlled mind, uncontrolled mind, and five senses. Manasasthi Indriyani Pratistani Karshati. In this material world, everyone has become a servant of the senses. Originally, everyone is a servant of Krishna, but in ignorance, one forgets this, and then one is engaged in the service of Maya through lusty desires, anger, greed, illusion, madness, and jealousy. Everyone is actually dependent on the reactions of material laws, but still one thinks himself independent and thinks that he has conquered all directions. In conclusion, one who thinks that he has many enemies is an ignorant man. whereas one who is in Krishna consciousness knows that there are no enemies but those within oneself, the uncontrolled mind and senses. Text 11. Hiranyakashipu replied, "You rascal, you are trying to minimize my value as if you are better than me at controlling the senses. This is over-intelligent. I can therefore understand that you desire to die at my hands, for this kind of nonsensical talk is indulged in by those who are about to die." Purport. It is said in the Hitupadesha, "Upadesho hi murkanam prakopaya nasantaye." If good instructions are given to a foolish person, he does not take advantage of them, but becomes more and more angry. Prahlad Maharaj's authorized instructions to his father were not accepted by Hiranyakashipu as truth. Instead, Hiranyakashipu became increasingly angry at his son, who was a pure devotee. This kind of difficulty always exists when a devotee preaches Krishna consciousness to persons like Hiranyakashipu, who are interested in money and women. The word Hiranya means gold, and Kashipu refers to cushions or soft bedding. Moreover, a father does not like to be instructed by his son, especially if the father is a demon. Prahlad Maharaj's Vaishnava preaching to his demonic father was indirectly effective because of Hiranyakashipu's excessive jealousy of Krishna and his devotee, he was inviting Nrisingadev to kill him very quickly. Thus, he was expediting his being killed by the Lord himself. Although Hiranyakashipu was a demon, he was described here by the added word Shri. Why? The answer is that fortunately he had such a great devotee son as Prahlad Maharaj. Thus, although he was a demon, he would attain salvation and return home, back to Godhead. Text 12. O most unfortunate Prahlad, you have always described a supreme being other than me, a supreme being who is above everything, who is the controller of everyone, and who is all-pervading. But where is he? If he is everywhere, then why is he not present before me in this pillar? Purport. Demons sometimes declare to a devotee that they cannot accept the existence of God because they cannot see him. But what the demon does not know, as is stated by the Lord himself in Bhagavad Gita 7.25, Naham prakasha sarvasya yogamaya samanvita. Quote, "I am never manifest to the foolish and unintelligent. For them I am covered by yogamaya," end quote. The Lord is open to being seen by devotees, but non-devotees cannot see him. The qualification for seeing God is stated in Brahma Samhita 5.38. Premanjana charita bhakti vilochanena santa sadaiva radyesu vilokayanti. A devotee who has developed genuine love for Krishna can always see him everywhere, whereas a demon, not having a clear understanding of the Supreme Lord, cannot see him. When Hiranyakashipu was threatening to kill Prahlad Maharaj, Prahlad certainly saw the column standing before him and his father, and he saw that the Lord was present in the pillar to encourage him not to fear his demonic father's words. The Lord was present to protect him. Hiranyakashipu marked Prahlad's observation and asked him, quote, "Where is your God?" End quote. Prahlad Maharaj replied, quote, "He is everywhere," end quote. Then Hiranyakashipu asked, "Why is he not in this pillar before me?" End quote. Thus, in all circumstances, the devotee can always see the Supreme Lord, whereas the non-devotee cannot. Prahlad Maharaj has here been addressed by his father as, quote, "the most unfortunate," end quote. Hiranyakashipu thought himself extremely fortunate because he possessed the property of the universe. Prahlad Maharaj, his legitimate son, was to have inherited this vast property, but because of his impudence, he was going to die at his father's hands. Therefore, the demonic father considered Prahlad the most unfortunate because Prahlad would not be able to inherit this property. Hiranyakashipu did not know that Prahlad Maharaj was the most fortunate person within the three worlds because Prahlad was protected by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Such are the misunderstandings of demons. They do not know that a devotee is protected by the Lord in all circumstances. Kuntiya pratijanihi name bhakti pranasiti. Text 13. Because you are speaking so much nonsense, I shall now sever your head from your body. Now, let me see your most worshipable god come to protect you. I want to see it. Purport. Demons always think that the god of the devotees is fictitious. They think there is no god, and that the so-called religious feeling of devotion to God is but an opiate, a kind of illusion, like the illusions derived from LSD and opium. Hiranyakashipu did not believe Prahlad Maharaj when Prahlad Maharaj asserted that his Lord is present everywhere. Because Hiranyakashipu is as a typical demon, was convinced that there is no God and that no one could protect Prahlad, he felt encouraged to kill his son. He challenged the idea that the devotee is always protected by the Supreme Lord. Text 14. Being obsessed with anger, Hiranyakashipu, who was very great in bodily strength, thus chastised his exalted devotee son, Prahlad, with harsh words. Cursing him again and again, Hiranyakashipu took up his sword, got up from his royal throne, and with great anger struck his fist against the column. Text 15. Then, from within the pillar came a fearful sound, which appeared to crack the covering of the universe. Oh, my dear Yudhisthira, when this sound reached even the abodes of the demigods like Lord Brahma, and when the demigods heard it, they thought, quote, oh, now our planets are being destroyed, end quote. Purport. As we sometimes become very much afraid at the sound of a thunderbolt, perhaps thinking that our houses will be destroyed, the great demigods, like Lord Brahma, feared the thundering sound that came from the pillar in front of Hiranyakashipu. Text 16. While showing his extraordinary prowess, Hiranyakashipu, who desired to kill his own son, heard that wonderful tumultuous sound which had never been heard before. Upon hearing the sound, the other leaders of the demons were afraid. None of them could find the origin of that sound in the assembly. Purport. In Bhagavad Gita 7.8, Krishna explains himself by saying, Rasoham apsukonteya prabhamsi shashushuryayo pranava sarva vedeshu sabta ke prananusam nrishu. Quote, O son of Kunti, Arjuna, I am the taste of water, the light of the sun and the moon, the syllable Om in the Vedic mantras. I am the sound in ether and the ability in man. End quote. Here, the Lord exhibited his presence everywhere by the tumultuous sound in the sky. Shabda K. The tumultuous thundering sound was proof of the Lord's presence. The demons, like Hiranyakashipu, could now realize the supreme ruling power of the Lord, and thus Hiranyakashipu became afraid. However powerful a man may be, he always fears the sound of a thunderbolt. Similarly, Hiranyakashipu and all the demons who were his associates were extremely afraid because of the presence of the Supreme Lord in the form of sound, although they could not trace out the source of the sound. Text 17. To prove that the statement of his servant Prahlad Maharaj was substantial, in other words, to prove that the Supreme Lord is present everywhere, even within the pillars of an assembly hall, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, exhibited a wonderful form never seen before. The form was neither that of a man nor that of a lion. Thus, the Lord appeared in his wonderful form in the assembly hall. Purport. When Hiranyakashipu asked Prahlad Maharaj, quote, where is your Lord? Is he present in this pillar? End quote. Prahlad Maharaj fearlessly replied, yes, my Lord is present everywhere. Therefore, to convince Hiranyakashipu that the statement of Prahlad Maharaj was unmistakably true, the Lord appeared from the pillar. The Lord appeared as half man, half lion, so that Hiranyakashipu could not understand whether the great giant was a lion or a human being. To substantiate Prahlad's statement, the Lord approved that his devotee, as declared in Bhagavad Gita, is never vanquished. Kotiya pratijanihi namai bhakti pranasiti. Prahlad Maharaj's demoniac father had repeatedly threatened to kill Prahlad, but Prahlad was confident that he could not be killed, but since he was protected by the Supreme Lord. By appearing from the pillar, the Lord encouraged his devotee, saying, in effect, quote, "Don't worry, I'm present here," end quote. By manifesting his form as Nrisingadev, the Lord also preserved the truth of Lord Brahma's promise that Hiranyakashipu was not to be killed by any animal or any man. The Lord appeared in a form that could not be said to be fully a man or a lion. Text 18. While Hiranyakashipu looked around, all around to find the source of that sound, the wonderful form of the Lord, which could not be ascertained to be either a man or a lion, emerged from the pillar. In amazement, Hiranyakashipu wondered, quote, "What is this creature that is half man and half lion?" End quote. Purport. A demon cannot calculate the unlimited potency of the Supreme Lord. As stated in the Vedas, Parasha Shakti Vividayavishyati Shvabhaivika Janabalakriyacha. The different potencies of the Lord are always working as an automatic exposition of his knowledge. For a demon, it is certainly wonderful that the form of a lion and the form of a man can be united, since a demon has no experience of the inconceivable power for which the Supreme Lord is called all-powerful. Demons cannot understand the omnipotence of the Lord. They simply compare the Lord to one of them. Avajananti ma mudha manasim tanamashritam. Mudhas, rascals, think that Krishna is an ordinary human being who appears for the benefit of other human beings. Parambhavama janata. Fools, rascals, and demons cannot realize the supreme potency of the Lord, but he can do anything and everything. Indeed, he can do whatever he likes. When Hiranyakashipu received benedictions from Lord Brahma, he thought that he was safe. Since he received the benediction, that he would not be killed either by an animal or by a human being. He never thought that an animal and human being would be combined, so that demons like him would be puzzled by such a form. This is the meaning of the Supreme Personality of Godhead's omnipotence. Texts 19 through 22. Hiranyakashipu studied the form of the Lord, trying to decide who the form of Nrisingadev standing before him was. The Lord's form was extremely fearsome because of his angry eyes, which resembled molten gold, his shining mane, which expanded the dimensions of his fearful face, his deadly teeth, his razor-sharp tongue, which moved about like a dueling sword. His eyes were erect and motionless. His nostrils and gaping mouth appeared like caves of a mountain. His jaws parted fearfully, and his entire body touched the sky. His neck was very short and thick, his chest broad, his waist thin, and the hairs on his body as white as the rays of the moon. His arms, which resembled flanks of soldiers, spread in all directions as he killed the demons, rogues, and atheists with his conch shell disc, club, lotus, and other natural weapons. Text 23. Hiranyakashipu murmured to himself, quote, "Lord Vishnu, who possesses great mystic power, has made this plan to kill me. But what is the use of such an attempt? Who can fight with me?" End quote. Thinking like this and taking up his club, Hiranyakashipu attacked the Lord like an elephant. Purport. In the jungle, there are sometimes fights between lions and elephants. Here, the Lord appeared like a lion, and Hiranyakashipu, unafraid of the Lord, attacked him just like an elephant. Generally, the elephant is defeated by the lion, and therefore the comparison in this verse is appropriate. Text 24. Just as a small insect falls forcefully into a fire and the insignificant creature becomes invisible, when Hiranyakashipu attacked the Lord, who was full of effulgence, Hiranyakashipu became invisible. This is not at all astonishing, for the Lord is always situated in pure goodness. Formerly, during creation, he entered the dark universe and illuminated it by his spiritual effulgence. Purport. The Lord is situated transcendentally in pure goodness. The material world is generally controlled by tamagun, the quality of ignorance, but the spiritual world, because of the presence of the Lord and his effulgence, is free from all contamination by darkness, passion, or contaminated goodness. Although there is a tinge of goodness in this material world in terms of brahminical qualifications, such qualifications sometimes become invisible because of the strong prevalence of the modes of passion and ignorance. Because the Lord is always transcendentally situated, the material modes of passion and ignorance cannot touch him. Whenever the Lord is present, there cannot be any darkness from the mode of ignorance. It is stated in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya 22:31, Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Antakara Yatan Krishna Tatan Mahi Mayara Adhikara. Quote, Godhead is light, nescience is darkness. Where there is Godhead, there is no nescience. End quote. This material world is full of darkness and ignorance of spiritual life, but by bhakti yoga, this ignorance is dissipated. The Lord appeared because of the bhakti yoga exhibited by Prahlad Maharaj. And as soon as the Lord appeared, the influence of Hiranyakashipu's passion and ignorance was vanquished as the Lord's quality of pure goodness or the Brahman effulgence became prominent. In that prominent effulgence, Hiranyakashipu became invisible or his influence became insignificant. An example illustrating how the darkness of the material world is vanquished is given in the Shastra. When Brahma was created from the lotus stem growing from the abdomen of Garbhadakshayi Vishnu, Lord Brahma saw everything to be dark, but when he received knowledge from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, everything became clear, as everything becomes clear when one becomes from night to sunshine. The important point is that as long as we are in the material modes of nature, we're always in darkness. This darkness cannot be dissipated without the presence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which is invoked by the practice of bhakti yoga. Bhakti yoga creates a transcendental situation with no tinges of material contamination. Text 25. Thereafter, the great demon Hiranyakashipu, who was extremely angry, swiftly attacked Nrisingadev with his club and began to beat him. Lord Nrisingadev, however, captured the great demon along with his club, just as Garuda might capture a great snake. Text 26. O Yudhishthir, O great son of Bharat, when Lord Nrisingadev gave Hiranyakashipu a chance to slip from his hand, just as Garuda sometimes plays with a snake and lets it slip from his mouth, the demigods who had lost their abodes and who were hiding behind the clouds in fear of the demon did not consider that incident very good. Indeed, they were perturbed. Purport. When Hiranyakashipu was in the process of being killed by Lord Nrisingadev, the Lord gave the demon a chance to slip from his clutches. This incident was not very much appreciated by the demigods, for they were greatly afraid of Hiranyakashipu. They knew that if somehow or other Hiranyakashipu escaped from Nrisingadev's hands and saw that the demigods were looking forward to his death with great pleasure, he would take great revenge upon them. Therefore, they were very much afraid. Text 27. When Hiranyakashipu was freed from the hands of Nrisingadev, he falsely thought that the Lord was afraid of his prowess. Therefore, after taking a little rest from the fight, he took up his sword and shield again and attacked the Lord with great force. Purport. When a sinful man enjoys material facilities, foolish people sometimes think, quote, how is it that this sinful man is enjoying, whereas a pious man is suffering? End quote. By the will of the Supreme, a sinful man is sometimes given a chance to enjoy the material world as if he were not under the clutches of material nature, just so that he may be fooled. A sinful man who acts against the laws of nature must be punished, but sometimes he's given a chance to play, exactly like Hiranyakashipu when he was released from the hands of Nrisingadev. Hiranyakashipu was destined to be ultimately killed by Nrisingadev, but just to see the fun, the Lord gave him a chance to slip from his hands. Text 28. Making a loud, shrill sound of laughter, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayan, who is extremely strong and powerful, captured Hiranyakashipu, who was protecting himself with his sword and shield, leaving no gaps open. With the speed of a hawk, Hiranyakashipu moved around sometimes some in the sky and sometimes on the earth, his eyes closed because of fear of Nishingadeh's laughter. Text 29. As a snake captures a mouse, or Garuda captures a very venomous snake, Lord Nishingadev captured Hiranyakashipu, who could not be pierced even by the thunderbolt of King Indra. As Hiranyakashipu moved his limbs here, there, and all around, very much afflicted at being captured, Lord Nishingadev placed the demon on his lap, supporting him with his thighs, and in the doorway of the assembly hall, the Lord very easily tore the demon to pieces with the nails of his hand. Purport. Hiranyakashipu had received from Lord Brahma the benediction that he would not die on the land or in the sky. Therefore, to keep the promise of Lord Brahma intact, Nrisimhadev placed Hiranyakashipu's body on his lap, which was neither land nor sky. Hiranyakashipu had received the benediction that he would not die either during the day or at night. Therefore, to keep this promise of Brahma, the Lord killed Hiranyakashipu in the evening, which is at the end of day and at the beginning of night, but is neither night, day nor night. Hiranyakashipu had taken a benediction from Lord Brahma that he would not die from any weapon or be killed by any person, dead or alive. Therefore, just to keep the word of Lord Brahma, Lord Nrisimhadev pierced Hiranyakashipu's body with his nails, which were not weapons and were neither living nor dead. Indeed, if the nails can be called dead, but at the same time they are said to be alive. To keep intact all of Lord Brahma's benedictions, Lord Nrisimhadev paradoxically but very easily killed the great demon, Hiranyakashipu. Text 30. Lord Nrisimhadev's mouth and mane were sprinkled with drops of blood, and his fierce eyes, full of anger, were impossible to look at. Licking the edge of his mouth with his tongue, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Nrisimhadev, decorated with a garland of intestines taken from Hiranyakashipu's abdomen, resembled a lion that had just killed an elephant. Purport. The hair on Lord Nrisimhadev's face, being sprinkled with drops of blood, was reddish and looked very beautiful. Lord Nrisimhadev pierced Hiranyakashipu's abdomen with his nails, pulled out the demon's intestines, and wore them as a garland, which enhanced his beauty. Thus, the Lord became very fearsome, like a lion engaged in fighting an elephant. Text 31. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, who had many, many arms, first uprooted Hiranyakashipu's heart, and then threw him aside and turned toward the demon's soldiers. The soldiers had come in thousands to fight with him with raised weapons and were very faithful followers of Hiranyakashipu, but Lord Nrisimhadev killed them all merely with the ends of his nails. Purport. Since the creation of the material world, there have been two kinds of men, the Devas and the Asuras. The Devas are always faithful to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whereas the Asuras are always atheists who defy the supremacy of the Lord. At the present moment, throughout the entire world, the atheists are extremely numerous. They are trying to prove that there is no God, that everything takes place due to combinations and permutations of material elements. Thus, the material world is becoming more and more godless, and consequently everything is in a disturbed condition. If this continues, the Supreme Personality of Godhead will certainly take action, as he did in the case of Hiranyakashipu. Within a second, Hiranyakashipu and his followers were destroyed. And similarly, if this godless civilization continues, it will be destroyed in a second, simply by the movement of one finger of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The demons should therefore be careful and curtail their godless civilization. They should take advantage of the Krishna consciousness movement and become faithful to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Otherwise, they are doomed. As Hiranyakashipu was killed in a second, the godless civilization can be destroyed at any moment. Text 32. The hair on Nrisimhadev's head shook the clouds and scattered from them here and there. His glaring eyes stole the effulgence of the luminaries in the sky, and his breathing agitated the seas and oceans. Because of his roaring, all the elephants in the world began to cry in fear. Purport. As the Lord says in Bhagavad Gita 10:41, Yad Yad Vibhuti Mat Sattvam Srimad Urjitam Eva Va Tat Tad Eva Gachatvam Mama Tejo Misha Sambhavam. Quote, know that all beautiful, glorious, and mighty creations spring but from a spark of my splendor. End quote. The illumination of the planets and stars in the sky is but a partial manifestation of the Lord's effulgence. There are many wonderful qualities of different living entities, but whatever extraordinary things exist are but the part of the Lord's tejas, his illumination or brilliance. The deep waves of the sea and oceans and the many other wonders within the creation of the Supreme Personality of God all become insignificant when the Lord, in his special feature, incarnates within this material world. Everything is insignificant in comparison to his personal, all-defeating, transcendental qualities. Text 33. Airplanes were thrown into outer space and the upper planetary system by the hair on the Shingadev's head. Because of the pressure of the Lord's lotus feet, the earth appeared to slip from its condition, and all the hills and mountains sprang up due to his intolerable force. Because of the Lord's bodily effulgence, both the sky and all directions diminished in their natural illumination. Purport. That there were airplanes flying the sky long, long ago can be understood from this verse. Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken 5,000 years ago, and the statements of this verse prove that the symptoms of a very advanced civilization then existed, even in the upper planetary systems as well as in the lower planetary systems. Modern scientists and philosophers foolishly explained that there was no civilization prior to 3,000 years, but the statement of this verse nullifies such whimsical judgments. The Vedic civilization existed millions and millions of years ago. It existed since the creation of this universe, and it included arrangements all over the universe with all the modern amenities and even more. Text 34. Manifesting a full effulgence and a fearsome countenance, Lord Nrisimha, being very angry and finding no contestant to face his power and opulence, then sat down in the assembly hall on the excellent throne of the king. Because of fear and obedience, no one could come forward to serve the Lord directly. Purport. When the Lord sat down on the throne of Hiranyakashipu, there was no one to protest. No enemy came forward on behalf of Hiranyakashipu to fight with the Lord. This means that his supremacy was immediately accepted by the demons. Another point is that although Hiranyakashipu treated the Lord as his bitterest enemy, he was the Lord's faithful servant in Vaikuntha, and therefore the Lord had no hesitation in sitting on the throne that Hiranyakashipu had so laboriously created. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur remarks in this connection that sometimes, with great care and attention, great saintly persons and rishis offer the Lord valuable seats decorated with Vedic mantras and tantras, but still the Lord does not sit upon those thrones. Hiranyakashipu, however, had formerly been Jai, the doorkeeper at the Vaikuntha gate, and although he had fallen because of the curse of the Brahmanas and had gotten the nature of a demon, and although he had never offered anything to the Lord, as Hiranyakashipu, the Lord is so affectionate to his devotee and servant that he nonetheless took pleasure in sitting on the throne that Hiranyakashipu had created. In this regard, it is to be understood that a devotee is fortunate in any condition of his life. Text 35. Hiranyakashipu had been exactly like a fever of meningitis in the head of the three worlds. Thus, when the wives of the demigods and the heavenly planets saw that the great demon had been killed by the personal hands of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, their faces blossomed in great joy. The wives of the demigods again and again showered flowers from heaven upon Lord Nrisimhadev like rain. Text 36. At that time, the airplanes of the demigods who desired to see the activities of the Lord Narayan crowded the sky. The demigods began beating drums and kettle drums, and upon hearing them, the angelic women began to dance while the chiefs of the Gandharvas sang sweetly. Text 37 through 39. my dear King Yudhisthira. The demigods then approached the Lord. They were headed by Lord Brahma, Lord King Indra, and Lord Shiva, and included great saintly persons and all and the residents of Prithviloka, Siddhaloka, Vidyadharaloka, and the planet of the snakes. The Manus approached, and so did the chiefs of various other planets. The angelic dancers approached, as did the Gandharvas, the Charnas, the Yakshas, the inhabitants of Kinara Loka, the Vaitalas, the inhabitants of Kimpurusha Loka, and the personal servants of Vishnu like Sunanda and Kamuda. All of them came near the Lord, who glowed with intense light. They individually offered their obeisances and prayers, their hands folded at their heads. Text 40. Lord Brahma prayed, "My Lord, you are unlimited, and you possess unending potencies. No one can estimate or calculate your prowess and wonderful influence, for your actions are never polluted by the material energy. Through the material qualities, you very easily create the universe, maintain it, and again annihilate it. Yet you remain the same without deterioration. I therefore offer my respectful obeisances unto you." Purport. The activities of the Lord are always wonderful. His personal servants, Jai and Vijay, were confidential friends, yet they were cursed, and they accepted the bodies of demons. Again, in the family of one such demon, Prahlad Maharaj was caused to take birth to exhibit the behavior of an exalted devotee, and then the Lord accepted the body of Narsingadev to kill that same demon who, by the Lord's will, had taken birth in a demoniac family. Therefore, who can understand the Lord's transcendental activities? Not to speak of understanding the transcendental activities of the Lord, no one can understand even the activities of his servants. In Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya 23:39, it is said, "Tanravakya Kriya Mudra Vignayad Nabujaya." No one can understand the activities of the Lord's servants. Therefore, what to speak of the activities of the Lord? Who can understand how Krishna is benefiting the entire world? The Lord is addressed as Duranta Shakti because no one can understand his potencies and how he acts. Text 41. Lord Shiva said, "At the end of the millennium is the time for your anger. Now that this insignificant demon, Hiranyakashipu, has been killed, O my Lord, who are naturally affectionate to your devotee, kindly protect his son, Prahlad Maharaj, who is standing nearby, as your fully surrendered devotee." Purport. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is the creator of the material world. There are three processes in creation, namely creation, maintenance, and finally annihilation. During the period of annihilation at the end of each millennium, the Lord becomes angry, and the part of anger is played by Lord Shiva, who is therefore called Rudra. When the Lord appeared in great anger to kill Hiranyakashipu, everyone is extremely afraid of the Lord's attitude. But Lord Shiva, knowing very well that the Lord's anger is also his lila, was not afraid. Lord Shiva knew that he would have to play the part of anger for the Lord. Kala means Lord Shiva, Bhairava, and Kopa refers to the Lord's anger. These words combined together as Kopa Kala refer to the end of each millennium. Actually, the Lord is always affectionate toward his devotees, even though he may appear very angry. Because he is Avyayatma, because he never falls down, even when angry, the Lord is affectionate toward his devotees. Therefore, Lord Shiva reminded the Lord to act like an affectionate father toward Prahlad Maharaj, who was standing by the Lord's side as an exalted, fully surrendered devotee. Text 42. King Indra said, "O Supreme Lord, you are our deliverer and protector. Our shares of sacrifices, which are actually yours, have been recovered from the demon by you. Because the demoniac king Hiranyakashipu was most fearsome, our hearts, which are your permanent abode, were all overtaken by him. Now, by your presence, the gloom and darkness in our hearts has been dissipated. O Lord, for those who always engage in your service, which is more exalted than liberation, all material opulence is insignificant. They do not even care for liberation, not to speak of the benefits of Kama, Artha, and Dhamma." Purport. In this material world, there are two kinds of people, the Devatas, demigods, and the Asuras, demons. Although the demigods are attached to material enjoyment, they are devotees of the Lord who act according to rules and regulations of the Vedic injunctions. During the reign of Hiranyakashipu, everyone was disturbed in the routine duties of Vedic civilization. When Hiranyakashipu was killed, all the demigods who had been disturbed, always been disturbed by Hiranyakashipu, felt relief in their general way of life. Because the government of Kali Yuga is full of demons, the living conditions of devotees is always disturbed. Devotees cannot perform yoga, and thus they cannot partake of the remnants of food offered in yoga for the worship of Lord Vishnu. The hearts of the demigods are always filled with fear of the demons, and therefore they cannot think of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The engagement of the demigods is to think of the Lord always within the cores of their hearts. The Lord says in Bhagavad Gita 6:47, Yoginam api sarvesham magadendantaratmana shadavan bhajate yo mam same yuktatamo mata. Quote, and of all yogis, he who always abides in me with great faith, worshipping me in transcendental loving service, is most intimately united with me in yoga and is the highest of all. End quote. The demigods fully absorb themselves in meditation upon the Supreme Personality of Godhead to become perfect yogis. But because of the presence of demons, their hearts were filled with the activities of the demons. Thus, their hearts, which are meant to be the abode of the Supreme Lord, are practically occupied by the demons. All the demigods felt relieved when Hiranyakashipu was dead, for they could easily think of the Lord. They could then receive the results of sacrifices and become happy, even though in the material world. Text 43. All the saintly persons present offered their prayers in this way. O Lord, O Supreme Maintainer of those sheltered at your lotus feet, O Original Personality of Godhead, the process of austerity and penance in which you instructed us before is the spiritual power of your very self. It is by austerity that you create the material world which lies dormant within you. This austerity was always stopped by the activities of this demon. But now, by yourself appearing in the form of Narsingadev, which is meant just to give us protection, and by killing this demon, you have again approved the process of austerity. Purport. The living entities wandering within the jurisdiction of the 8,400,000 species of life get the opportunity for self-realization in the human form, and gradually in other such elevated forms as those of demigods, kinaras, and charnas, as will be described below. In the higher statuses of life, beginning from human life, the main duty is tapasya, or austerity. As Rishabhdev advised his son, tapo divyam putakadena sattvam sudayat, to rectify our material existence, austerity, tapasya, is absolutely necessary. However, when people in general come under the control of a demon or a demoniac ruling power, they forget this process of tapasya and gradually also become demoniac. All the saintly persons who are generally engaged in austerity felt relieved when Hiranyakashipu was killed by the Lord in the form of Narsingadev. They realize that the original instruction concerning human life, that it is meant for tapasya, for self-realization, was reaffirmed by the Lord when he killed Hiranyakashipu. Text 44. The inhabitants of Prithviloka prayed, let us offer our respectful obeisances unto Lord Narsingadev, the maintainer of the religious principles of the universe. He has killed Hiranyakashipu, the demon who by force enjoyed all the offerings of the Shraddha ceremonies performed by our sons and grandsons on the anniversaries of our death, and who drank the water with sesame seeds offered in holy places of pilgrimage. By killing this demon, O Lord, you have taken back all this stolen property from his abdomen by piercing it with your nails. We therefore wish to offer our respectful obeisances unto you. Purport. It is the duty of all householders to offer food grains to all their departed forefathers. But during the time of Hiranyakashipu, this process was stopped. No one would offer Shraddha oblations of food grains to the forefathers with great respect. Thus, when there is a demoniac rule, everything concerning the Vedic principles is turned upside down. All the religious ceremonies of yoga are stopped, and the resources meant to be spent for yoga are taken away by the demoniac government, and everything becomes chaotic, and consequently the entire world becomes hell itself. When the demons are killed by the presence of Nrsingadev, everyone feels comfortable, irrespective of the planet upon which he lives. Text 45. The inhabitants of Siddhaloka prayed, O Lord Nrsingadev, because we belong to Siddhaloka, we automatically achieve perfection in all eight kinds of mystic power. Yet Hiranyakashipu was so dishonest, but by the strength of his power and austerity, he took away our powers. Thus he became very proud of his mystic strength. Now, because this rogue has been killed by your nails, we offer our respectful obeisances unto you. Purport. On earth, there are many yogis who can exhibit some feeble mystic powers by manufacturing pieces of gold like magic, but the inhabitants of the planet Siddhaloka are actually extremely powerful in mysticism. They can fly from one planet to another without airplanes. This is called Laghima City. They can actually become very light and fly in the sky. By a severe type of austerity, however, Hiranyakashipu excelled all the inhabitants of Siddhaloka and created disturbances for them. The residents of Siddhaloka were also beaten by the powers of Hiranyakashipu. Now that Hiranyakashipu had been killed by the Lord, the inhabitants of Siddhaloka also felt relieved. Text 46. The inhabitants of Vidyadharaloka prayed, Our acquired power to appear and disappear in various ways according to varieties of meditation was banned by that foolish Hiranyakashipu because of his pride in his superior bodily strength and his ability to conquer others. Now, the Supreme Personality of Godhead has killed him just as if the demon were an animal. Unto that supreme pastime form of Lord Nrsingadev, we eternally offer our respectful obeisances. Text 47. The inhabitants of Nagaloka said, The most sinful Hiranyakashipu took all the jewels on our hoods and all our beautiful wives. Now, since his chest has been pierced by your nails, you are the source of all pleasure to our wives. Thus, we together offer our respectful obeisances unto you. Purport. No one is peaceful if his wealth and wife are forcibly taken away. All the inhabitants of Nagaloka, which is situated below the earthly planetary system, were in great anxiety because their wealth had been stolen and their wives kidnapped by Hiranyakashipu. Now, Hiranyakashipu having been killed, their wealth and wives were returned, and their wives felt satisfied. The inhabitants of various lokas or planets offered their respectful obeisances unto the Lord because they were relieved by the death of Hiranyakashipu. Disturbances similar to those created by Hiranyakashipu are now taking place all over the world because of demoniac governments. As stated in the 12th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the men of the governments of Kali Yuga will be no better than rogues and plunderers. Thus, the population will be harassed on one side by scarcity of food and on another by heavy taxation by the government. In other words, the people in the most parts of the world of this age are harassed by the ruling principles of Hiranyakashipu. Text 48. All the Manus offered their prayers as follows. As your order carriers, O Lord, we, the Manus, are the lawgivers for human society. But because of the temporary supremacy of this great demon, Hiranyakashipu, our laws for maintaining Varnashram Dharma were destroyed. Now, O Lord, that you have killed this great demon, we are in our normal condition. Kindly order us, your eternal servants, what to do now. Purport. In many places in Bhagavad Gita, the Supreme Lord Krishna refers to the Varnashram Dharma of four Varnas and four Ashrams. He teaches people about this Varnashram Dharma so that all of human society can live peacefully by observing the principles of the four social divisions and four spiritual divisions, Varna and Ashram, and thus make advancement in spiritual knowledge. The Manus compiled the Manu Samhita. The word Samhita means Vedic knowledge, and Manu indicates that this knowledge is given by Manu. The Manus are sometimes incarnations of the Supreme Lord and sometimes empowered living entities. Formerly, many long years ago, Lord Krishna instructed the sun god. The Manus are generally sons of the sun god. Therefore, while speaking to Arjuna about the importance of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna said, Imam Vashvate Yogam Proktaham Avayavayam Vivishwan Manave Prabha. quote, "This instruction was given to Vivishvan, the sun god, who in turn instructed it to his son Manu," end quote. Manu gave the law known as Manusamhita, which is full of directions based on Varna and Ashram concerning how to live as a human being. These are very scientific ways of life, but under the rule of demons like Hiranyakashipu, human society breaks all these systems of law and order and gradually becomes lower and lower. Thus, there is no peace in the world. The conclusion is that if we want real peace and order in the human society, we must follow the principles laid down by the Manusamhita and confirmed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. Text 49. The Prajapatis offered their prayers as follows. O Supreme Lord, O Lord of even Brahma and Shiva, we, the Prajapatis, were created by you to execute your orders, but we were forbidden by Hiranyakashipu to create any more good progeny. Now the demon is lying dead before us, his chest being pierced by you. Let us therefore offer our respectful obeisances unto you, whose incarnation in this pure form of goodness is meant for the welfare of the entire universe. Text 50. The inhabitants of Gandharva Loka prayed, Your Lordship, we ever engage in your service by singing and dancing in dramatic performances, but this Hiranyakashipu, by the influence of his bodily strength and valor, brought us under his subjugation. Now that he has been brought to this low condition by your Lordship, what benefit can result from the activities of such an upstart as Hiranyakashipu? Purport. By being a very obedient servant of the Supreme Lord, one becomes extremely powerful in bodily strength, effulgence, and influence, whereas the fate of demonic upstarts is ultimately to fall down like Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu and persons like him may be very powerful for some time, but the obedient servants of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, like the demigods, always remain powerful. They are victorious over the influence of Hiranyakashipu by the grace of the Supreme Lord. Text 51. The inhabitants of the Charna planet said, quote, O Lord, because you have destroyed the demon Hiranyakashipu, who was always a stake in the hearts of all honest men, we are now relieved, and we eternally take shelter of your lotus feet, which awarded the conditioned soul liberation from material contamination. Purport. The Supreme Personality of Godhead in his transcendental form of Narahari, Nisingadev, is always ready to kill the demons who always create disturbance in the minds of honest devotees. To spread the Krishna consciousness movement, devotees have to face many dangers and impediments all over the world. But a faithful servant who preaches with great devotion to the Lord must know that Lord Nisingadev is always his protector. Text 52. The inhabitants of Yaksha Loka prayed, O controller of the 24 elements, we are considered the best servants of your lordship because of rendering services pleasing to you, yet we engaged as palanquin carriers by the orders of Hiranyakashipu, the son of Diti. O Lord, in the form of Nisingadev, we now know this demon gave trouble to everyone, but now you have killed him and his body is mixing with the five material elements. Purport. The Supreme Lord is the controller of the 10 senses, the 5 material elements, the 5 sense objects, the mind, the intelligence, the false ego, and the soul. Therefore, he is addressed as Pancha Vimsa, the 25th element. The inhabitants of the Yaksha planet are supposed to be the best of all servants, but Hiranyakashipu engaged them as palanquin carriers. The entire universe was in trouble because of Hiranyakashipu, but now that Hiranyakashipu's body was mixing with the 5 material elements, earth, water, fire, air, and sky, everyone felt relief. Upon Hiranyakashipu's death, the Yakshas were reinstated in their original service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, thus they felt obliged to the Lord and offered their prayers. Text 53. The inhabitants of Kimpurusha Loka said, We are insignificant living entities, and you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Supreme Controller. Therefore, how can we offer suitable prayers unto you? When this demon was condemned by devotees because they were disgusted with him, he was then killed by you. Purport. The cause of the Supreme Lord's appearance upon this earth is stated in Bhagavad Gita 4, 7, and 8 by the Lord himself. Yada yada hi dharmasya glani bhavati bharata abhyutanam adharmasya tadatmanam shichijami aham. Pratitanaya sadhanam vinaschaya chaduskritam dharma samastapanashaya sambhavami yuge yuge. Quote, whenever and wherever there is a decrease in religious principles and a prominent rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself to deliver the pious and annihilate the miscreants, as well as to reestablish the principles of religion. I advent myself millennium after millennium. End quote. The Lord appears in order to execute two kinds of activities, to kill the demons and to protect the devotees. When the devotees are too disturbed by the demons, the Lord certainly appears in different incarnations to give protection to the devotees. The devotees following in the footsteps of Prahlad Maharaj should not be disturbed by the demonic activities of non-devotees. Rather, they should stick to their principles as sincere servants of the Lord and rest assured that the demonic activities directed against them will not be able to stop their devotional service. Text 54. The inhabitants of Vaitalika Loka said, "Dear Lord, because of chanting your spotless glories in great assemblies and arenas of sacrifice, we were accustomed to great respect from everyone. This demon, however, usurped that position. Now, to our great fortune, you have killed this great demon exactly as one cures a chronic disease." Text 55. The Kinnaras said, "O Supreme Controller, we are ever-existing servants of your lordship, but instead of rendering service to you, we were engaged by this demon and his servants, constantly and without remuneration. This sinful man has now been killed by you. Therefore, O Lord Nrisingadev, our master, we offer our respectful obeisances unto you. Please continue to be our patron." Text 56. The associates of Lord Vishnu in Vaikuntha offered this prayer. "O Lord, our supreme giver of shelter, today we have seen your wonderful form as Lord Nrisingadev, meant for the good fortune of all the world. O Lord, we can understand that Hiranyakashipu was the same Jai who engaged in your service but was cursed by Brahmanas and who thus received the body of a demon. We understand that his having now been killed is your special mercy upon him." Purport. Hiranyakashipu's coming to this earth and acting as the Lord's enemy was prearranged. Her Jai and Jivai were cursed by the Brahmanas, Sanaka, Sanat Kumar, Sanandana, and Sanatan, because Jai and Vijay checked these four Kumars. The Lord accepted this cursing of his servants and agreed that they would have to go to the material world and would then return to Vaikuntha after serving the term of the curse. Jai and Vijay were very much perturbed, but the Lord advised them to act as enemies, for then they would return after three births. Otherwise, ordinarily, they would have to take seven births. With this authority, Jai and Vijay acted as the Lord's enemies, and now that these two were dead, all the Vishnudutas understood that the Lord's killing of Hiranyakashipu was special mercy bestowed upon them. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the 7th canto, 8th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled, "Lord Nrisingadev Slays the King of the Demons."